Mr. B. Dhanasekar is working as a lecturer in Department of Information Technology, Anna University, Chennai. He finished his MCA from Urumu Dhanalakshmi College, Bharathidasan University. He finished his ME in Computer Science and Engineering from College of Engineering, Anna University. His areas of interest are multi-core programming and architecture, programming models, compiler, automata theory, cryptography, and algorithms. He is an expertise in subjects like compiler design, formal languages and automata theory, analysis of algorithms. His research area is code generation for multi-core architecture.
Welcome to the UGC lecture series on computer science. We are having the subject that is compiler design. And in the previous episode, we have seen that is how the first symbols of the various grammar symbols in a grammar are computed. Actually, we are trying to construct the predictive parsing table, and it is one of the top down parser. So, the predictive parsing table is required for parsing the strings between the top down parser. So, to construct the predictive parsing table, actually we will be given the context free grammar. First of all, we must ensure that the context free grammar is free from ambiguity. So, if you have ambiguity and if you proceed with that, certainly we will be end up with a parsing table which may not be useful for us. So, that is the reason why first we eliminate the that is the ambiguity available in the grammar, and once the ambiguity is removed, then we will go for eliminating the left recursion available in the grammar. So, once the left recursion is over, then we will go for eliminating the left factoring available in the grammar. So, if these two, if these three problems are removed, then we will be having the grammar which will be that is suitable for constructing the predictive parsing table. So, that is the idea. So, when you that is after eliminating the left recursion and left factoring, we need to compute two sets. So, one is called the first set for all the variables available in the grammar, and the other one is called the that is the follow set. So, in the previous episode, we have seen the algorithm for computing the first set. Using that, we will be able to find out the very first terminal available in all sentential forms derived from a particular grammar symbol. So, that is applicable for all the grammar symbols which will be needed for constructing the predictive parsing table. So, today we are having the that is a follow set computation, which is once again needed for computing the constructing the predictive parsing table. Let us see if, what is going to be the algorithm first of all, and then we shall see with an example how the predictive parser, the follow set of the various variables are constructed. So, here is the algorithm. So, we have the starting symbol of the grammar that is said to be the S, and we have a special symbol called S which is not introduced as far as the first set is concerned. Here it is, the dollar, the special symbol. So, what do we assume here is every string derived from a grammar symbol must derive from the starting symbol of the grammar must end up with the dollar. That is the terminator for a string. So, that is what we that is have this as a special symbol, and this is supposed to be the symbol following all the strings derived from the start symbol of the grammar. So, we should immediately that is initial step itself, we must introduce dollar into the follow set of the start symbol of the grammar. So, that is the step number 1 of the follow set computation, and then we are having two more important steps which are required for constructing the follow sets for the various variables available in the grammar in an iterative manner. First, let us see that is a production. So, we have generally the, since it is going to be a context free grammar, we will be having the productions of the form A derives alpha, but where we see the right hand side as the format that is alpha B beta. So, we know that alpha and beta are any sentential forms which are actually from the variables unions the terminals its closure. That is any number of variables or any number of terminals or any combination of variables and terminals any number of times including epsilon. So, that is about your alpha and beta, and now we are having there is a B in between this alpha and beta. So, what the first rule says is the beta should not be equal to epsilon. That means, at the that is what we wanted to have next to this B is at least one symbol. That is the reason why we have the condition beta not equal to epsilon. So, in that case, what we should do here is you compute the first set of beta and remove epsilon. I said that beta not equal to epsilon, but that does not mean that first of beta should not have epsilon. Suppose if beta is starting with the variable, and for that if we have a production of the form that variable derives epsilon, then first of beta will have epsilon, but we will remove that first of that is epsilon from first of beta here and find out the rest of the symbols. So, that is nothing but your first of beta except epsilon, and everything will be moved to follow of b. So, here the you can even go for the construction the parse tree for this particular production. It looks like a will be the root and followed by it is having three branches. On one branch we will be having alpha, and the next one is middle is going to be b, and then followed by we are having beta. So, what we are going to learn from this particular context is we are trying to know who are all the symbols following this b. So, whoever is following this b, it should be the first symbol from beta. That is what we understand by this particular context. So, that is the reason why we take first of beta. And another interesting thing is, so we are removing epsilon out of this. So, the reason why we remove epsilon is, even if it is going to be the the sentential form deriving the whole sentence from the start symbol of the grammar, we are very sure that when beta becomes epsilon or when first of beta becomes epsilon, we will not be ending with an epsilon, but we will be ending with a dollar. Or otherwise, if beta is followed by any other variable, then that variable will be having some first symbol. This epsilon, whenever it comes into this beta and it is going to be replaced at least by that is a dollar or by some other symbol from the first of whatever the sentential form following this beta. So, that is the reason why we are removing epsilon from first of beta, and all the symbols other than the first of all the symbols other than epsilon from first of beta will be eligible for following any sentence derived from that is a, which is nothing but your b, followed that is b is followed by all the symbols. So, that is the rule number 2. So, what it says is, first you split up the production in this form, we should have three components on the right hand side. It is going to be the alpha, then we identify a variable, then followed by some beta. It can be the combination of variables and terminals n number of times. So, now you compute first of beta minus epsilon and move them into the follow set of b. Then we are having the next important rule. So, here we are having the productions of the form a derives alpha b or a derives alpha b beta. We have two forms, but the condition there is the first of beta contains epsilon. So, that is the meaning. So, when you take the second option, that is your a derives alpha b beta. So, what happens here is this beta may derive epsilon. If beta strictly derives epsilon, then this production will be reduced to a derives alpha b. So, that is the first version. So, even though two versions are there, so both could be that is simply written as one version as here a derives alpha b beta, where beta is followed by that beta may even be epsilon. So, beta may epsilon means the production itself is ending with b, or if beta derives epsilon, in that case also whenever beta derives epsilon the production ends with b. So, in that case what should be seen is, or the outcome is, everything following that is a is going to follow b. So, if you look at the there is a parse tree for this particular the production, so then what will happen is, so we will be having a parse tree like here we are having a, and then we will be having that is alpha, and then we will be having here it is something like your beta, and here we have that is b. So, the idea what it says is everything following a should follow b. So, the condition is, so this beta is supposed to derive that is epsilon. So, when beta derives epsilon, automatically all the symbols that are following this a will actually follow even that is b also. So, that is what we say, that every symbol in follow of a will be following that is b. That is the rule number 3. So, we have seen two number of rules. In one, we are finding the first set and then moving into the follow of b, and in another one, the already pre-computed that is follow set variables symbols of the left hand side will be moved on to one of the variable on the right hand side, provided that variable will be the end symbol of the right hand side. So that is a condition where that variable will be the end symbol of the right hand side. So in these two cases, we find the follow set of some of the variables. But if you stop it just like this, then we may not be able to compute the entire set of the follow symbols for all the variables. So that is the reason why we are going for repeating these two steps until otherwise we find no more additions are possible in any of the follow set. That is our rule number 4. So you are having that is apply the rules 2 and 3 repeatedly until nothing can be added into any of the follow set. So actually these two rules are supposed to be repeated as long as we have more addition, that is updations on the follow set, and whenever we find no more addition or updation on the follow set, then we can simply that is come out and say that it is the follow set has been completely computed. So we can have one simple example. So here we have the grammar. So this is the grammar equivalent for the expression grammar E derives E plus E or E star E or open bracket E closing bracket or identifier, and we get the grammar from that expression grammar after eliminating the ambiguity available in the grammar, then after eliminating the left recursion available in the grammar, and then after eliminating the left factoring available in the grammar. Actually this grammar does not have any left factor, common factor, but whereas we had two productions with left factoring, sorry, left recursion, and the left recursions were eliminated. So as a result of that, we are having this grammar. So E derives T followed by E dash or E prime, then E prime is plus T E prime, and E prime is otherwise epsilon, and then T is F followed by T prime, or T prime is going to be star F T prime is epsilon, and the final two productions are meant for F. So F is either open bracket E closing bracket or F is ID. So this is what the that is the grammar given for us, and now we have to find out the follow set for the various variables available in the grammar. So actually in the given grammar we had the variables E, T and F, but after eliminating the left recursion and left factoring, and that is after that is introducing or after eliminating the ambiguity available in the grammar, we find that certain new variables have been introduced, but it is now required to compute the first set and follow set for all the variables available in the grammar. So that is the reason why we are having all these variables here. So now we shall apply the algorithm, the follow set algorithm. So the follow set algorithm, the first step is, the first step of the follow set algorithm says that introduce dollar into the follow set of the start symbol of the grammar. The start symbol of the grammar here is E, and so that is the reason why we find dollar has been introduced into the follow set of that is E. So that is a base condition. So without bothering about what is the grammar and what are the various symbols available in the grammar, so we can blindly that is insert that dollar, because dollar is the terminal which is the end symbol for all strings derived from the start symbol of the grammar. So the start symbol of the grammar is strictly followed by the dollar. And the next algorithm, step of your algorithm, what it says is, so we will be having that is A derives alpha B beta. So what we the production format is, we have seen that A derives alpha B beta. So everything from first of beta will now be in follow of that is B. So if you apply this production into, so this rule into this particular production, so what will happen is this becomes your A, and this is going to be your that is alpha. We find that alpha is epsilon here, and this becomes your B, and this becomes your beta. So you can have this writing here. So it is going to be your, the production is of the rule is of the form A derives, then it is going to be alpha, and then B, and then it is going to be beta. So this is the rule, and the output is first of beta minus epsilon is going to be in follow of B. So what it means is you compute the first of E dash, and that will go for follow of that is E. So first of E dash, we know that first of E dash is going to be either plus or epsilon, but what the rule says is first of beta but minus epsilon will be introduced into follow set of T. So that is the reason why we find plus will be in follow set of T. So we are having now follow set of T has plus here. So that has been already computed now. And once again the same logic is now applicable for this algorithm, that is plus T E dash. So the same story, we find that your E dash is first is plus and epsilon, and once again plus will be moved on to follow set of T. So that doesn't change that is any option there. Now we are having that is E dash derives epsilon, but whereas E dash derives epsilon, no rule is applicable as far as the follow set computation is concerned here. And when you go for the next one, we find that you are having T is F T dash, the same rule. This is going to be your that is beta, and this is your B. So what happens here is first of T dash minus epsilon. So first of T dash is going to be star and epsilon, but star is already that is star we are supposed to include, but epsilon should not be included as per the algorithm. So what do you find here is star will be moved on to the follow set of F. So you will be having star here. So this is the next one which we have that has seen. So this is now available, and the same thing is going to be applicable out that is allowed even in your that is your T dash also. So T dash first of T dash minus epsilon is going to be in follow of T. And when you are going for T dash derives epsilon, we do not find out any that is modification. It does not have any influence in computation of follow set. And whereas the production F derives open bracket E closing bracket is concerned, we are computing the first set of the closing bracket. The first set of closing bracket is closing bracket itself because it is going to be a terminal. And since it is going to be a terminal, we will go for moving the terminal into the follow set of E. So because of that, we are having the closing bracket in follow set of E. So this is what now we are having. So now we find that the rule number 2 has been applied on all the productions, all applicable productions, all applicable productions. As a result of that, we are getting the following the risk computations. Let us go for a break, and after that we shall see that is how we are applying the rule number 3. Welcome back. So we have seen that is how the follow set is going to be computed for the given context free grammar after elimination of left recursion, left factoring, and even before that we would have completed the elimination of ambiguity also. So there are three number of rules, and rule number 2 and 3 are supposed to be repeated until we find that no more changes can be made on any of the follow set. As far as the context free grammar which we are given here is concerned, we have applied the rule number 2, and now let us see that is how we are applying the rule number 3. Let us take once again the same grammar. Here we are having that is our E derives T E dash etc. Let us take the rule number 3 here. So the rule number 3, what it says is, so A that is derives, so we will be having that is alpha that is B and that is beta, and the condition is going to be beta should derive that is epsilon. So that is what the condition. Here it is applicable for this rule. Actually we can that is say that E dash is now eligible for beta because of first of E dash has epsilon. First of E dash has both plus and epsilon. So we can take that this is beta. So in that case everything from E will be moved on to T. So follow of E dollar and epsilon, so closing bracket, and they will be moved on to T. Already we had plus with this. Now as an introduction of by introducing dollar and closing bracket here, we are having dollar, closing bracket and plus as far as follow set of T is concerned. And next the same rule is going to be used for the production number 2. The production number 2, what it says is E prime derives plus T followed by E prime, and now once again your E prime becomes the that is your beta, which has epsilon in its follow set, sorry first set. And now what should be done is everything from E dash will come to T. So E dash had that is dollar and closing bracket, and they will be moved on to follow of T, so which does not make any difference as far as follow of T is concerned. So now moving on to the third production, which does not have any influence in the computation of Fuller set, and we have T derives F T dash. So what will happen here is find out whether first of T dash is epsilon or not. We have epsilon in first of T dash because T dash derives epsilon as a production. So then what will happen is, as a result of the rule number 3, everything from T will be moved on to F. That is, every follow symbol from T will be moved on to F. So already we have dollar closing bracket and plus with T, and because of that we will find the dollar in follow of F and the closing bracket in follow of F and the plus in follow of F, and already we had a star also. So now we have the follow set of F. So next what should be done is, we can go for the application of the rule for T dash derives this one. So the same thing happens, follow set of T dash will come for the follow set of F. So now we have, that is, your T dash derives epsilon. So we have seen that is the T dash does not have any influence on the computation of the follow set. And now once again, when you are looking at the F derives open bracket E closing bracket, we have our B as this E here, and this is becoming your beta. But what the condition says here is, this beta must derive epsilon, but we know that this closing bracket does not derive epsilon. Closing brackets first set is going to be only closing bracket, since it is not capable of deriving epsilon. So we will not be able to move the follow set of F to the follow set of E. And also we can understand that, so if you go for F, strictly the string is going to be ending with closing bracket, nothing else. That is the reason why we should not introduce the follow set of F into the follow set of E. So this is what the step number 3. So now we have completed, there is one iteration of the step number 2 and step number 3. So we can continue with the application of the step number 2 and step number 3, we find that no more inclusion is possible in any of the follow set. And we can apply the rule number 2 as we have applied earlier. So there will be some number of inclusions into the follow set, and go for rule number 3, once again some inclusions will be there in your follow set, and at the end of that we will find that the follow set of all the variables have been obtained clearly. So we should know that what is the symbol which can be available in the follow set of a variable. There is any terminal which can follow the string derived from that particular variable. So for example, if I am having the variable called a, so if small a is going to be in the follow set of a, then this capital A derives some string, but which is going to be followed by this small a. So we can construct all these follow sets of the various variables just by constructing the parse tree for the various productions. Otherwise we can apply this simple algorithm, so that we will be able to find out the follow set of all the variables available in the grammar. So now we have completed the first set computation and the follow set computation. So once the first set computation and follow set computation are over, and we can move on to the construction of the predictive parsing table. So the parsing table is going to be the most important, that is, component of any parser, because the construction of the parsing table is going to be an one-time event. And the parsing is going to be done for every string which you are going to parse. So now look at the structure of the parsing table here. This is going to be a two-dimensional array where the contents are going to be row-wise and column-wise we have. And see, this M denotes the name of the parsing table, that is the name of the table. And we find that the columns are indexed by the lowercase letters. We can have A, B, C, D, E, and finally even that is dollar also. So the which means that since it is labeled with the lowercase letters, we can understand that they are the terminals. And whereas the rows are indexed by the variables A, B, C, D, E, etc., which means all the variables available in the given context-free grammar. That is after elimination of left recursion and left factoring. So the rows are indexed by variables, and the columns are indexed by terminals. And what do we have in various cells? So you can see that there is a cell being marked with red, and which has a label called parsing action or error. So what do we have in the parsing table is, the different parsing actions for the different combinations of variables and terminals. So we will be having the variable on the left hand side, and there will be a right hand side which will be having some first set that is available on the right hand side. Now on seeing the particular intersection of the parsing table, we will be able to decide, so what kind of action we are supposed to take. So we know that the parser can go for a shift operation or a reduce operation, or that is, it can go for an accept operation, which means that the string has been accepted successfully or the parsing parse tree has been constructed successfully. So if none of these three happens, then which means that there is an error available in your parsing process. So either we will be having a shift action or reduce action or accept, or otherwise we will be having a error action. So that is what being mentioned here. So every cell will be having either a parsing action or we can have an error. So now the question is, how do we construct this parsing table? So we have a very simple algorithm here, which is going to be the first one we will be having each production. The productions are of the form A derives alpha, and there are two steps. The step number 2 says how do we make use of the first set, and the step number 3 says how do we make use of the follow set. So what do we say here is, if A derives alpha is a production, then we will be having the first set of this alpha, that is for the right hand side, and for every terminal available in the first set of this right hand side, so we will be adding this production A derives alpha into the intersection of the table M of A comma A. So this A is the left hand side of the production, and the small a is going to be the first symbol available for the right hand side, and that intersection is now going to be labeled with A derives alpha. So that is rule number 2. And when you go for rule number 3, so first you should know, when do we apply the rule number 3? That is, if epsilon is in first set of alpha, then we find that we don't have any kind of terminal other than epsilon as far as first set of alpha is concerned. So strictly we cannot go for applying the rule number 2, because the rule number 2 is meant only for terminals other than epsilon. So now to fill the parsing table entries, so we should go for finding the follow set of the left hand side of the production. That is what we are computing, the follow set of A. And now the intersection is this A, once again the left hand side of the production, followed by small b. The small b is, that is for each terminal B in follow set of A. That is, for every terminal which is going to be there in the follow set of A, we will be introducing the rule A derives alpha. So there are two cases. The first one is we compute the that is first symbol of the right hand side. So if the first symbol of the right hand side is going to be a non epsilon content, then we will fill up that entry, that is A comma the first symbol of the that is alpha, using that production. And whenever we find that the first of the right hand side is going to be an epsilon, in that case we will go for computing the follow set of A. And the follow set of A will be having the terminals, actually once again what is going to be the first, which is nothing but following that A. But on that intersection we will go and write the production called A derives alpha. So do this for all the productions, and finally we will be having many of the entries available in the parsing table gets filled. But there will be still some entries which are not yet filled, and all those entries are denoting, that is, erroneous actions. And all these entries which are filled will be either denoting an epsilon, that is, or shift action, or going to be a reduce action. As far as the predictive parsing table is concerned, we do not have any kind of explicit accept action, but that will be considered whenever you find that the buffer is empty and the stack is also empty. We will say that the complete thing is processed and the parsing action has been successful. So that is about the predicting parsing table construction algorithm. And so we have seen that the how we are constructing the first set and how we are constructing the follow set for every variable available in the given grammar after eliminating that is ambiguity, left recursion and left factoring. And then we have seen that is how we are constructing the parsing table with the help of a parsing table construction algorithm. So that is about this this one. So the parsing table, once we have constructed, we will be able to, that is, parse the strings with the help of the parsing table. So the parsing table is going to be used by the parser for deriving strings. So actually the outcome of the parsing table, that is the parsing table, will be actually used for constructing the parse tree for any sentence. So the parsing table has been table construction has been over means the parser has been constructed. So rest of the thing is just you read the strings from the input, and they will be, that is given as input for this predictive parsing table, and based on various actions automatically the strings will be parsed, parsing table tree will be constructed as the output. So the questions component, we are having that is what is going to be the algorithm for the construction of the follow set, and how we are constructing the predictive parsing table, and what is going to be the structure of the predictive parsing table. The predictive parsing table is going to be a two-dimensional array, so where we will be having the rows indexed with the variables available in the grammar, and columns indexed with terminals available in the grammar. And what does it mean? That is, we are having empty cells in your predictive parsing table. What do they refer? So the empty cells available in the predictive parsing table are referring the that is erroneous actions. So when you are constructing an that is a parser which is going to be an that is error handling parser, so those entries will be filled with some appropriate that is entries which will be dealing with those that is errors. So these are going to be the possible that is questions from this component. And with this, I complete this episode. Thank you all.